Let's go to Jacob first. Hey, Jacob, good to hear from you.
Hey, Steve, I'm here in Tacoma, Washington. My question has to do with freedom, and I'm talking about freedom in Christ. I thought of the word free, and I have the question of if I am free. And I know there's a verse that says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. I don't know if you have anything you want to say about that, but I don't know if that's the only verse that talks about freedom or being free in the Bible. But I'm wondering what I'm free from and what I'm free to.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's not the only verse that talks about liberty. Liberty is freedom too. And Paul says it is for liberty that Christ has set us free. Therefore, don't be entangled again in a yoke of bondage. Of course, what Paul's talking about there in Galatians is he's talking about freedom from the Jewish law. Whereas when Jesus says the truth will make you free, they asked him about that. They said, what do you mean about that? And he said, well, whoever commits sin is a slave of sin. So the different references to freedom have different reference. Jesus talked about being set free from sin, from the power of sin, from the bondage of sin. And he said that happens if we continue in his words and we are his disciples indeed, then we'll know the truth and the truth will make us free. That's in John 8, 31 and 32. And that would mean that as we follow Christ's words, that he will set us free from our misconceptions. There's always misconceptions underlying bondage to sin. Whenever we sin, we are succumbing to some misconception. If nothing else, we're assuming that the penalties or the things we'll suffer or the damage that'll be done by our sins will not be anywhere near as great as our pleasure in it, which is almost always a lie. And so, I mean, believing lies is what keeps us in bondage to sin. The Bible says that the devil also keeps us in bondage by the fear of death in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14 and 15. So, you know, can the fear of death is a lie too, because we have nothing to fear in death if we're Christians. So we just don't have to be in bondage to the devil or to sin, but we also, according to Galatians, are not in bondage to the law. Now that's a slightly different thing, because the Judaizers that Paul is opposing in Galatians are telling the Gentile believers that they have to keep the law of Moses, that they need to become proselytes to Judaism, essentially get circumcised. And Paul said, well, if you do that, you're going to be a debtor to keep the whole law. There's all 613 rules in the law of Moses. You're going to have to keep them all if you get circumcised. And so don't do that, because that'll put you under bondage like the Pharisees were under, to continually be wondering, am I touching something that's unclean? Am I eating some food that I'm going to have to be sorry for? Am I observing these laws in every letter? I mean, 613 laws, you'd always have to be nervous whether there's one of them you're forgetting. But Paul said, yeah, we don't have to think about that. We don't have to worry about that. We're free in Christ. Our freedom is the freedom to walk in the Spirit. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 17, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. And again, that means the liberty to walk according to the new nature that God has given us. Now, when you're walking according to what's your nature, when you're doing what you actually want most to do, you're living in freedom. If you're not doing what you want most to do and you're doing something you don't want to do, you're in bondage to something. The idea is, if you're a follower of Christ, the Holy Spirit dwells in you. You have been a partaker of the divine nature. And therefore, the things that your heart has changed. Your heart has changed. He's written his laws on your heart. And therefore, you want to be a godly and a holy person. And the freedom to do that is something that only believers have, because only Christ sets us free from the bondage of sin. That's what the angel said to Joseph in Matthew chapter 1. He said his name will be called Jesus, because he'll save his people from their sins. So people are slaves of sin until they're set free from that, delivered from that. And that's what Jesus does. So the freedom we have is the freedom to follow Christ without worrying about laws and so forth from a different religion, which was Judaism. And we don't have to worry about that we're in bondage to sin. We're not in bondage to sin. Christ gives us the power to overcome sin as we walk in the power of his Spirit. Paul said in Galatians 5:16, Paul said, therefore, walk in the Spirit, and we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So if we walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, we don't fulfill the sinful lusts of the flesh. So that's freedom.
Okay. I don't have a religion, but I'm a Christian. Mm-hmm. And somebody recently told me that I don't have to worry about the law unless I break it. What do you think about that?
You don't have to worry about the law of Moses at all, but the law of Christ. Remember, Paul said, when I'm with those who are under the law, I can behave like one under the law, meaning the Jewish law. Though he says, though I'm not under the law. But he says, but when I'm with those who are without the law, I can live without the law. But he says, but I'm not without law to God. I'm under the law of Christ. So we have to realize that following Jesus and doing what he said is basically all we're expected to do. And it comes naturally to us if we walk in the Spirit, because his Spirit in us is that which lives the Christian life in us. We simply have to walk in the power and under the guidance of his Spirit. And that's what freedom is.
Thank you.
All right. Hey, good talking to you. Again, good to see you again. Let's see, is Dale and Petey next? Am I right?
Good evening, Steve, and everybody.
Hi, guys.
We are in Milwaukee, Wisconsin area.
Great.
And the question of the night for me is about the where the scripture talks about God judging nations.
Uh-huh.
We find that, I think, in Matthew 25, 31 to 46. And reading through that, it seems that the judgment will be based on whether nations loved God's people. And correct me if I'm wrong, Steve. And I just wonder what does it seem like that's going to look like?
There's two very different ways of understanding that parable of the sheep and the goats there in Matthew 25, 31 through 46. And that is that the dispensationalists believe that that judgment is a judgment of nations as complete nations as to which ones will be allowed to go into the millennium when Jesus comes back. And when Jesus comes back, he'll allow some nations to continue to exist in the millennial reign, and he'll reign over them there. Other nations, he will not. And it says in the parable that the ones who were not allowed to are the ones who did not do to his brethren what should be done. I was hungry and you didn't feed me. I was naked and you didn't clothe me. And he said, when you didn't do it to my brethren, you didn't do it to me. Now, the dispensational view is that Jesus' brethren that he's referring to are the Jewish people, and that the nations are the Gentile nations, and that the nations will either be allowed to go into the millennium or not, based on whether they treated the Jewish people well or not. Now, first of all, I don't believe that's an accurate understanding of the parable. I'll tell you in a moment why not. But I would say, even if that was the right understanding, we have to say, well, what portion of that nation's history are we thinking about? Aren't there nations that have been reasonably just and kind to Jewish peoples at some points in their history and not at others? Certainly Germany, before Hitler came to power, you know, Jews had freedom and prosperity in that nation. And, you know, there might've been a few anti-Semites around. There always have been in every nation, but I mean, they weren't really persecuted there. Well, I don't know exactly just before the Nazis came to power if they were, but obviously some nations have their seasons where they've treated Jews reasonably well and other seasons where they didn't. And so I just don't really see that that's a possible measure for nations to be judged by. Besides, I don't think that's a correct understanding at all. I don't believe any of the assumptions. I don't believe that nations are to be judged as nations. The word nations is the same word as Gentiles. So he's going to call all the Gentiles before him, all the nations, and all the nations would include, you know, the Jewish nation and the Gentile nations. And so it just means all people, not just pagans, not just Jews, but all nations are going to have to stand judgment. I'm putting a cough drop in my mouth because my throat is a little rough. So it's going to click around on my teeth for a little while. So I just believe he's talking about he'll judge everybody. Now, I don't believe that his brethren refers to the Jews, because Jesus, you know, when his mother and brothers came looking for him, he wouldn't even grant them an audience. And he said, who are my mother and who are my brothers? Those who do the will of my Father in heaven, they are my mother and my brothers and my sisters. In other words, he didn't, not only did he not identify the Jewish race as his brothers, he didn't even identify the particular Jewish people who were his actual relatives as his brothers. My brothers are those who do the will of God, of my Father, he said. So Christ's brethren, there's nothing in the New Testament that would suggest that he speaks of his brethren, meaning the Jewish race. I mean, he said he was the Son of God, and he said that they, some of them, he said, were the children of the devil, you know, in John 8:44. So that wouldn't make them brothers. So I don't believe that he's talking about how nations treat the Jews. Thirdly, I don't believe he's talking about who's going into the millennium and who's not. I myself am all millennial, so I don't even believe there will be a millennium after Jesus comes back. I believe the millennium is symbolic for the age prior to Jesus coming back, from his first coming to his second coming. And after that, and when Jesus comes back with the new heavens, the new earth. In other words, people go not into a 1,000-year interim when Jesus comes back. They go into their eternal state. And that's exactly how the parable describes it. It says that the sheep go into everlasting life and to inherit the kingdom that was, you know, for them. And he says in verse 46, they go into eternal life. In the same verse, which is the last verse of the chapter, it says the others go into eternal punishment or everlasting punishment. Now, what that seems to mean is this is not deciding who's going into a 1,000-year provisional, you know, temporary period of time. Both parties are said to go into their eternal rewards. So there's absolutely nothing in the passage that supports the dispensational ideas for it. Now, what does it mean then? Well, I just believe it means that people who are Christians, who are his sheep, are the ones who exhibit his love for people. And remember, Jesus said in John 13:35, by this all men will know you're my disciples if you have love one for another. And that's not just the way you feel about each other. That's remember, it says in 1 John, if you have this world's goods and you see your brother have need and you shut up your bowels of compassion for him, how does the love of God dwell in you? So in other words, you see your brother in need and you can help him and you don't help him. Well, then that's not the love of God. When Jesus said you have to love your neighbors yourself, and the lawyer asked him, how, what's that look like? Who's my neighbor? And Jesus told the parable of the Good Samaritan. And the Good Samaritan saw a man in need and inconvenienced himself and made sacrifices to help the man and meet his needs. And then Jesus said, which was the neighbor to the one who fell among the thieves? And he said, well, I guess the one who had mercy on him. And Jesus said, well, then go and do so likewise. In other words, loving your neighbors, you love yourself, is something you do, not something you feel. You see your neighbor in need and you do unto him what you'd want done to you. Jesus said, that's the whole law and the prophets. So when somebody on the day of judgment, when we are, when all people, all nations, all Gentiles and Jews are brought before Christ, we will be judged by whether we had the evidence that we are in fact his disciples, whether we loved people, whether we loved our brothers who are his brethren also. Now, in other words, the sheep and the brethren in the parable are the same people. At least that's how I understand it. Some people have speculated they may not be, but of course the dispensationalists think the brethren of Jesus are the Jews and the sheep are the Christians. But both Jesus calls his followers his brethren, and he calls them his sheep in other places. So there's no reason to see it otherwise. The idea is they show themselves to be his sheep by treating the other Christians besides themselves well, knowing that they are his brothers and he's got a vested interest in them being treated well, and he'll avenge them if they're not. So the way we treat each other is what that's talking about. And if it sounds like it's saying, well, then are people saved by doing good deeds? No, people are saved by following Jesus, by trusting Christ, by embracing him as Lord and King. And if you embrace him as your Lord, if that means anything to you, by the way, if it doesn't, then it doesn't mean anything to God either. But if it means something to you, it means you want to be like him. You want to follow him. You want to please him. You want to walk as he told you to walk. And that's going to be evidenced by the way you treat other people. So although we're saved by faith, the evidence that we're saved is, frankly, the evidence that we have faith. Faith without works is dead. Paul said in Galatians 5:6, what matters to God is a faith that works through love. So it's faith. It's faith that saves us, but it's not just believing something. It's a faith that changes something and changes the way we live. And the way we live, if we have that faith, is the way that Jesus describes the sheep being in the parable. So all the, you know, all the places where Jesus or Paul or Peter or James or the book of Revelation mention the judgment day, they always say everyone's going to be judged by their deeds, by their works. But that doesn't mean they're saved by their works. We're saved by our surrender to Christ, by our trust in him. But you can tell if someone's done that or not by the way they live. So it's like if they haul you into court on charges and you say, well, I'm innocent, they'll bring out, well, let's see the evidence. You know, here's exhibit A, here's exhibit B. On the day of judgment, if we say, well, hey, I believed in Jesus, we'll say, oh, well, that's wonderful. Let's bring out the evidence and see. And, you know, your works will show if you did or not. I mean, that's what judgment is for. It's for looking at the evidence. Salvation is by faith, but works are the evidence that, that one has faith.
Can you go?
Yeah, it's on.
Steve, thank you so much. We've listened to so many of your teachings and have learned numerous things, and it's really enhanced our walk with Jesus. And I guess my question to follow up with that is, all the translations say nations. Do you have any insight on why nations and why not just saying peoples or people?
The word nations and the word Gentiles are really the same in the Greek. So I think, you know, because the King James translated nations, it kind of set a precedent. Translators have to decide when they find that word, am I going to translate nations or am I going to translate Gentiles? And since there was some precedent set, lots of translations, you know, they just follow the precedent of the earlier translations. Since either word will work, there a lot of translations don't see any reason to just change it for any reason. Because when Jesus said, go and make disciples of all nations, you know, I believe he means individual disciples. I don't think the whole nation is discipled. And so to say nations, you know, the idea of a nation state, like we assume exists in all over the world, now there's these different nation states, that's a very modern idea. Nations were ethnic groups in the Bible. Like the table of nations in Genesis 10, it lists like 70 different nations, which are really just ethnic groups, people descended from this guy, people descended from this guy, people descended from, you know, Asher, from these different guys. A nation in the Bible is really an ethnic group. And when Israel is considered a nation, it's considered as an ethnic group to a large extent. Although Gentiles can be part of it because there was a covenant that was perhaps an important delineator of their nationhood. But that, I think the word nations to the modern reader suggests the idea of a political nation state. Whereas in biblical times, the word nation referred to an ethnos, an ethnic group. And that's the same thing as what the Gentiles were considered. The nations usually is a term that means the Gentiles. It is entirely possible for Jews to be called a nation because there was the nation of Israel. But it's the most common thing in the Bible is to contrast Israel from the nations, meaning the nations are the Gentiles.
Thank you so much, Steve.
My pleasure. Great talking to you guys. You guys were on last time too, weren't you?
We were.
For a while.
Good. That's great to get to know you. God bless you.
Thank you. Lord bless you.
All right. Thank you. Let's talk to Boyd.
Hi, Steve.
Hi.
I'm coming in from Marysville, Washington, and I'm enjoying your topical study on biblical counseling for a change.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm seeing a counselor, and one of the things I'm working on is sleep deprivation. And he was suggesting a technique, and I wanted to ask you if you know about the technique and what your thoughts are on it. It's called EFT tapping, and it stands for Emotional Freedom Technique. Are you familiar with that?
Never heard of it.
Okay. It's touching places on your face and your hand and tapping and kind of talking about to yourself or out loud about something that you're trying to deal with, an anxiety or a pain or something, like, you know, could be physical or.
How does it work? Is it working?
I tried it once and it worked for me, and I tried it a second time and it didn't. And mm-hmm. I started doing some research on it, and it's touching areas that are nerve endings that go to the amygdala in the brain.
Okay.
And the rhythmic tapping for a while on one and then moving to another, and is supposed to help. But I was seeing a lot of kind of new age connections with it, and she almost like an acupuncture, you know, without using needles, and just wondered if it's okay to do it, but not to say things in some of the things I'm hearing them saying are self-actualization statements, and that's not what I would do. I would do it and be praying to the Father and asking for help with this. And I don't know if it's okay or if it's something just to stay away from.
Well, I'm not familiar with it. It does sound kind of new agey. I mean, on the other hand, it doesn't sound entirely like the occult or anything like that. I mean, it doesn't sound demonic. I can't really say that it's a dangerous thing they're doing. If it works for you, I would just say check your spiritual pulse from time to time, see if you're having any adverse effects in your spiritual life. I doubt that you will. I doubt that there'll be a problem with it. But again, I don't really know much about that kind of a thing.
Okay.
All right.
If you find something out about it, would you say it on one of your shows?
It's called EFT.
It stands for Emotional Freedom Technique. And or you can look it up by tapping.
Hmm. Okay. If I ever learn anything about it, I'll try to say something about it or get back to you next time.
Okay. Thanks.
Hey, Boyd. God bless you, man. Derek.
Hi.
Hi there.
First time on Zoom. I've called you maybe two or three times over the last year. I'm from Vancouver Island in Canada.
Oh, great.
And pleased to be with you all tonight. I'm conducting a personal Bible study through the Gospel of Matthew, and I'm in chapter 17, the Transfiguration, and I think I, as much as you can, have my head around it. But there's a couple things I wanted to ask you about. In verse 9, it says, as they're coming down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man has risen from the dead. Now, did he mean to those three disciples, don't even tell the other guys? Or did he mean like no one?
He probably didn't mean don't tell the other disciples, but he did definitely mean not to, you know, publicize it. I don't know whether they told the other nine guys or not, but I seriously doubt that he was would have objected to that, because, you know, Jesus often told people, even when he healed them, don't tell anyone about this, you know? And yet, of course, how could they not tell anyone about this? I mean, when you've been paralyzed and then you go home, walking home, everyone's going to say, what happened? You know, you're not going to be able to say, Oh, I don't know, nothing, just another day. You know, obviously it'd be impossible to say nothing at all. But I think what he's saying is, in general, don't spread this around. You know, don't make a big deal about this. And I think the reason is that he was concerned that people were already, because of the healings he did publicly and so forth, they were already getting a little bit hyped up about him. And on one occasion, when he publicly fed the 5,000, they tried to make him king by force. You know, I mean, it's like they had this messianic fervor to have a king that would drive out the Romans, and they wanted to force their agenda upon him to be that kind of a Messiah. And he was not interested in that. And I think he just wanted to keep the enthusiasm curbed. You know, obviously when he told someone, don't tell anyone about this, well, there's got to be, I mean, that can't be the kind of command, like, you know, you're going to really make me mad if you tell your wife what happened here, or, you know, if you tell your parents what happened. I think it's rather, he's just saying, listen, let's not make a big deal about this. Let's not spread this around. Because already, you know, the Bible says he'd go into villages and they couldn't even hardly walk through the streets. The streets were so choked with people. He couldn't even go into a building sometimes, you know, because they're already waiting for him, too crowded. And, you know, he'd get no rest. He'd get no sleep. And so I think Jesus, he did miracles and those kinds of things in order to communicate to his disciples and to give reason for the crowds to know that he was sent from God. But he never really publicly announced he was the Messiah. He told the woman of the well that in private when no one else was there. He told Caiaphas that when he was on trial before the court, only because Caiaphas asked him, are you the Messiah or not? I mean, it was very unusual for Jesus to even admit that he was the Messiah, not because he wasn't. I mean, his disciples knew. I mean, Caesarea Philippi, Jesus said, who do you say I am? They said, you're the Messiah. He said, blessed are you, you know, the Father revealed that to you. So obviously he's not trying to keep things a total secret. He's just trying to, I think, not allow them to get out of hand because people were so enthusiastic, you know, for him to publicly say he was the Messiah. That'd be just the thing that would cause them to want to riot against Rome and thrust him up as their king and so forth, which is not what he was there for. He wasn't there to do that to Rome. And also, I think, it was obvious that there was enough evidence publicly done to convince people that he really was who he said he was, but he wasn't running a publicity campaign for himself. He wanted to be promoted by his Father, not by, you know, himself or by, you know, other zealous people too early. When he said, don't tell anyone about what this vision you saw, I mean, that would have excited a lot of people to hear about it, but don't tell them until the Son of Man is risen from the dead. Why? Because it's too late for him to mess things up. You know, people can't mess things up once he's risen from the dead. He can appear and disappear and ascend into heaven and so forth. So I think it was mainly that because of the power that people could physically exert over him in under the wrong circumstances, that he just wanted to keep things on the down low a little more. Still gave plenty of evidence to his disciples who he was, including the Mount of Transfiguration for the three that were there. And again, I don't think he'd have any objection to the other nine knowing about it at that point too, but I think he didn't want to make that a big public thing.
Well, fair. Then my second complication was in verse 11, when he's talking about Elijah coming, and I know that that's referencing Malachi and John the Baptist was that type, but when he says, we'll restore all things, like John the Baptist restored some things, but all things, what are the all things?
Well, I believe that when he says Elijah truly does come first and restores all things, that's what Jesus said when they said, why did the scribes say Elijah must come first? He was actually paraphrasing Malachi chapter 4, verses 5 and 6 from the Septuagint. It doesn't read that way in our Hebrew text, but they used the Septuagint. They didn't usually use the Hebrew text in New Testament times. Most people were using the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation. And in the Septuagint, It says, behold, I send Elijah the prophet, and he will restore all things. Or basically, he'll restore relationships between, remember how it says it in the Hebrew, the restore the heart, or return the heart of the father to the children, and the children to the father, and so forth. It reads a little differently than that in the Septuagint. But the point is, when Jesus said Elijah truly does come first and restores all things, he's paraphrasing the verse in Malachi in answer to his disciples. His disciples, why do the scribes say Elijah's come first? Well, there's this verse here that says Elijah is going to come and restore all things. Now, to restore all things in that context seems to be proper relationships between the Jewish people, fathers and sons and neighbors and so forth. And that's, of course, John did preach those things. When the soldier said, what must we do? He said, well, do violence to nobody. To the average person, he said, if you have two coats, give one to him who has none, you know, and he who has food, let him do likewise. I mean, basically, John is telling people kind of the same thing Jesus was telling them later. Jesus hadn't started talking to them yet when John was saying it. But, you know, love your neighbors, you love yourself. And so John came and prepared the way for Jesus to introduce those priorities again. So I think that that's that one line there in verse 11 is that is essentially a half quote, slightly paraphrase of Malachi passage, which is telling the disciples what they asked. Why do the scribes say he's coming? Well, because of this verse here, because of Malachi. But then he says, but I say, Elijah has come first. Elijah has come, and they've done to him whatever he wants. And it says they understood he's talking about John the Baptist. Interesting, when Jesus, he quotes the verse from Malachi, but then he says, but I say to you, or I say to you, that's sort of like what Jesus did in the Sermon on the Mount. You've heard that it was said, and he'll quote something from the Old Testament. They say, but I say it to you. And so this is kind of his way of correcting what the scribes said. But he basically quote the passage, or at least allude to the passage that they've been, then he'd give his interpretation and say, well, I say it's already happened.
Thank you. That's super helpful. I appreciate it. I'm enjoying this, and I'll let you go for the next question. Thank you.
Derek, do you know that I have lectures verse by verse through Matthew at the website, and the lectures are only 22 minutes each. They're the shortest lectures on the website, and they are, there's 200 of them going through Matthew.
Hey, that's great. So yeah, I'll do that and compliment my study. Thanks. That's great.
Great to meet you, Derek.
You as well. Thank you.
God bless you.
You as well.
Okay. All right, Eddie, then. Welcome.
Thank you, Stephen, and thank you for all your work. And I guess I don't really have a question. It's more of a comment. I don't know if you're familiar with BFS, Bible Study okay. Fellowship.
Sure.
And guess what book they're doing?
Revelation.
In August. Revelation, exactly. And I've been on the last two meetings. I was the one that asked you the question about dispensationalism and how you were the first one that introduced me to coming out of dispensationalism, and then being amillennial, and then about, you know, the destruction of the temple and how a lot of the items were fulfilled there. And I've been listening to your series on eschatology and what are we to make of Israel, and just, you know, a lot of information that you put out there. And plus, you do these Zoom meetings, which are amazing, because you know, we have an opportunity to talk directly to you. And I don't think there's a lot of people that are putting themselves out there like you are, and doing all the work. So I you know, I appreciate that. Thank you. And but I went ahead and bought your book as well. Mm-hmm. So I'm preparing myself for BFS, and I'm expecting some major battles.
Well, I hope there aren't any battles, because
discussions.
BSF is dispensational, but so are many, many evangelical Bible study curricula and groups. You know, that group was started back in the 50s by Miss Johnson, who wrote the curriculum for BSF. And my mom back in the 50s lived in San Bernardino, where Miss Johnson was teaching. And my mom actually took the first course under Miss Johnson herself, who's not. But my mom's been through all the BSF stuff, so I know what they teach and stuff. And I get calls from time to time from people who are going through BSF and when they're doing Revelation, because they do Revelation periodically. I would just say, I wouldn't rock the boat. I would say you can in the discussion portions, you could say, well, do you realize there's actually some other views of Revelation out there? And, and just kind of, I would suggest do what I do in my book. I don't recommend any one of them, in my book. Now in my lectures, I do. I make it very clear what I believe. But in my book, I actually don't advocate any one view. I just present what each of them says. And that way, you wouldn't really be causing a battle. You would just be educating them that there are some other ways to look at it. But I would never go into BSF and try to upset them. And that is...
Get kicked out.
Get kicked out, or even try to persuade them of another view of Revelation. I don't believe that being persuaded of a particular view of Revelation is particularly important. I mean, I do believe I'd rather be right than wrong if I have a view about something, and I think that I'm right. But even if somebody else is right and I'm wrong, or if I'm right and they're wrong, it usually has almost nothing to do with the way they live their Christian life.
Right. And I think the major point difference is Israel.
That's true. But the funny thing is Revelation doesn't even mention Israel. You do have 144,000. So the decision whether they are Jews or not, some people think they're spiritual Jews. I believe they're literal Jews, but I believe they're Christian Jews. And I believe it says in Revelation 14 that they're the first fruits unto God. Now, James, who is a first century Christian Jew, wrote his epistle to first century Christian Jews. And he said, God has chosen us to be the first fruits of his creatures. So the very same thing that Revelation says about the 144,000, James, speaking to other first century Jewish Christians like himself, says, we're the first fruits here. They're the first fruits of the general evangelistic harvest of the church age. And so the strong suggestion, in my opinion, in Revelation, is that the 144,000 are Jewish Christians who lived in the first century, and they're sealed to avoid the plagues and the judgments that come in the book, because those Christians in Jerusalem did escape the fall of Jerusalem and the plagues that were associated with it. So because I believe Revelation is primarily talking about events that happened back then, it's quite natural to see them as Jewish people who fled and escaped because they were Christians and they were warned by Christ to do so. But
would you recommend reading Josephus as well? Or how hard is Josephus?
I'll tell you, in my book there, under the preterist column, I have quotes from Josephus mostly when they're relevant. Josephus wrote a book as big as my book on Revelation, but he's not writing on Revelation. He's just writing about Jewish history. And it's very interesting. An educated person would probably want to read Josephus, but most of what Josephus says doesn't have direct reference to passages in Revelation. It's just that if you read Josephus, you'll find out what a horrible Holocaust that was. But there are some things that Josephus says that seem to connect directly to some passages in Revelation, though he didn't know that. He never had read the book of Revelation. So, I mean, those passages I actually have in my book under the preterist.
Yeah. I think I heard some of them in your series on Revelation about like the hail, the size of the hail, and then about the stones that they painted white. And it's very interesting. Well, I said I wasn't going to ask a question, but I already asked like three, so I apologize.
Hey, well, I'm glad you're studying it. Great to, but just be a peacemaker and don't try to push.
Okay. I'll try.
But you're not going to change BSF.
I'm not. You're right.
You might change a few people's minds, but I'm not sure that would be the most peaceable way to relate with that organization.
Yeah. Kill them with love.
Yeah. Amen. Well, Eddie, God bless you, man.
God bless you.
Thank you for joining us. All right. Salt is next.
Oh, sorry, Steve. She just texted in that she doesn't have a microphone. She did type a question, though.
Okay.
See if I can find that. Maybe I can Hi, as a Christian, how to balance between helping serving people and letting people taking advantage of us? Should Christians being taken advantage of, is it within our capability to help? So obviously she's feels like someone's been utilizing her maybe too much. So as a Christian, where do we find that balance of being used or not? That's her question.
Yeah. Well, that is something that has to be finessed. Because there's not a dark border line. There's not a boundaries line, so to speak. You know, there's books about boundaries, which are just about that kind of thing. But actually, the Bible doesn't lay out any boundaries about that. I mean, when Jesus said, if a man wants to sue you and take your coat, give him your cloak also. If a man forces you to go 1 mile, go two with him. But give to everyone who asks you and so forth. If a man strikes you on one cheek, turn the other cheek. That kind of behavior is classic, enabling behavior, you might think. You know, these people they abuse you a little bit, so you let them abuse you more. But of course, Jesus is using hyperbole there. He doesn't really mean you should give to every person who asks. Well, otherwise, you'd spoil your kids rotten. You can't give the kids everything they ask for. You can't give every radio show money. There's too many radio shows, and they're all asking you for money. So, I mean, you can't give to everybody who asks you. But he is speaking in hyperbole that you should be not protective of your own space, not protective of your own stuff in such a way as that you would cling to your rights to it when somebody else actually has needs and would be benefited by it. Now, there's always going to be more people who need money than you've got money to give. So, I mean, you don't have to just lay out everything you have and just give it to the homeless, because obviously giving to the homeless is you enabling. You are enabling their behavior. When you're giving to drug addicts, you are. And similarly, when you simply let people walk all over you, there are times when you have to realize, okay, this is not really benefiting them. I may be showing what a great servant I am and what a humble Christian I am by letting this happen, but that's not what this is about. Jesus isn't teaching you how to show how humble and good you are. He's basically showing you how to love your neighbor. Assuming your neighbor needs something, give it to him. Assuming the soldier needs you to carry his goods for him for a mile, well, give him 2 miles. This is not to be followed legalistically. It's simply Jesus' way of giving examples of what it looks like to die to yourself and to lay down your rights for other people's benefit. But it's not always going to benefit them. There are people who make a career of victimizing other people. And if you just let them victimize you and without any protest on your part, or without any withdrawing of your availability to them, you're just enabling them. And Jesus himself rebuked those who struck him at his trial. And so did Paul. When Paul was on trial, someone struck him unrightly. He said, "You whited wall, God will judge you for striking me like that because it's unjust. You did it against the law." Now, in other words, to confront people when they need to be confronted, not when I need to do it. See, that's the thing. A lot of times we'll answer back or we'll retaliate or we'll defend ourselves because we feel the need to do that for us. No, we should do it when they need it. We should rebuke them when they need it. We should withstand them when they need to be withstood. But when submitting to their request is what they really need, then we should do that. The point of Jesus' teaching is not that we become, people without a backbone, and we're just, things that people can exploit for themselves. The idea is that we're in control of our situation. We can, if someone strikes you on one cheek, they're trying to provoke you. If you just turn the other cheek, you're showing you're the one in control of your reactions, not them. They would like to be in control. I mean, anyone who strikes you on the cheek is expecting you to get angry. But if you don't, they're not controlling you. So it's not a matter of giving people control over your life. It's a matter of you having the control to say no to your urges and no to your own selfishness when it will benefit others for you to make that kind of a sacrifice. On the other hand, there are people who live as, you know, parasites on others. And for you to let them be a parasite on you is simply, you know, supporting their behavior. And so when Jesus said Luke 17, I think it's in verse 3, he said, if your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. So in other words, rebuking him is you confront him about it. You say, hey, that wasn't okay. I'm not going to hit you back. I'm not going to retaliate. But I'm going to tell you, that's not behavior that God approves of, or that I'm going to let you get away with, you know, with me. I'm going to, you know, I'm not just going to stand there and let that happen, because it's not going to be good for you. Like I said, this has to be finessed. We can't just take what Jesus said and apply it legalistically, because even he didn't follow it legalistically. He's not being legalistic. The Pharisees were legalistic. Jesus is trying to lay out principles and not laws. So in my opinion, you need to ask yourself, when this person is taking advantage of me, is it time for me to say no? Is it time for me to teach them by saying no, that they can't just use people? Because that's not good for them. If you're establishing them in that habit, it's going to be harder for them to ever be the kind of people that please God. And that's what they should do. That's what they need to do. And that's what you need to encourage them to do. But, you know, if somebody, for example, borrows money from you and they become unable to pay it back and they ask you to forgive them, you should be glad to forgive them. It's not easy, but obviously if they have a desperate need for that. But if they keep borrowing money and not paying it back, then that's a habit you should say, well, I don't think I'm helping you when I lend you money. I think I'm just teaching you how to be a, you know, a predator on other people. So that's not something I approve of or God approves of. So no, I'm not going to help you this time. Just have to use wisdom. Let's talk to Twyla. Hi, Twyla. Are we frozen here or something? Is there some reason that...
No, Twyla, her mic is muted.
Oh, there. I'm here.
Okay, hi, Twyla. Go ahead.
Hi, Steve. It's great to see you again. I recently came in contact with you in Corpus, California, just a few months ago. So it's a great privilege to talk to you again. I have a question for you. I'll just give you a baseline here. I was watching a video of an Islamic man questioning a Christian woman regarding the discrepancies in the Bible. And the one that he brought up was regarding the genealogy of Jesus in Matthew 1:16 and Luke 3:20-23. What he was questioning, who is Jesus based on his lineage and discrepancy in the scriptures, which led us to Jeremiah 22:30. Where it talks about the curse of the kingship.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So can you clarify that? Because where I'm thinking, did God...
I can explain that. By the way, I have a couple lectures in my Authority of Scripture series about alleged contradictions and alleged discrepancies in the Bible. And let's see.
That's somebody else's mic.
Scott, you might need to...
I'll take care of it, Steve. Go ahead. I'm tracking down.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I have lectures called Alleged Discrepancies in the Bible that are found in the series called The Authority of Scripture. But that's a classic one, the genealogies of Jesus. It's evident that Matthew gives the genealogy of Joseph. And the reason he does so is because Jesus had his legal standing in Jewish society based on Joseph's lineage, because Joseph was his legal father. He was his, we could say his stepfather, we could call him his foster father, but his adoptive father. But whatever, Jesus' lineage officially was that through Joseph. But of course, his biological lineage was not through Joseph, because Joseph was not really his father. Now, Joseph had come through the kingly line from David through Solomon and all of Solomon's descendants, including Jeconiah. Now, as you mentioned in Jeremiah, There's a curse on the family of Jeconiah. In fact, God says that no child of his, no son of Jeconiah, will ever rule over the children of Israel again. Now, that would mean that the Messiah could not, because he's going to be the king of Israel. He cannot be descended from Jeconiah. So Jesus wasn't. He didn't come through Joseph, but Joseph was. And Joseph provided the legal standing for Jesus in society, although Jesus was not his offspring. Now, the interesting thing is that there's a catch-22 here in that curse in Jeremiah 23:30, because if somebody was descended from Jeconiah, that curse would prevent him from qualifying to be the king of Israel or the Messiah. On the other hand, if a person didn't come through Jeconiah, they didn't come through the royal line, so they wouldn't have the natural lineage qualifying them to be king, because basically the king is the son of the previous king and so forth on down. So Matthew tells us that Joseph came through the royal lineage all the way down to the generation of Joseph himself. And that meant that Joseph was in a position to be, as it were, of the kingly lineage, but Joseph could never be the king because he was biologically related to Jeconiah. Now, Jesus, on the other hand, what came through Mary? Now, we don't have any lineage in the Bible that says that it's Mary's lineage, but we do have a second lineage of Jesus in Luke chapter 3, beginning at verse 23. And it's a different one than the one in Matthew. Now, Joseph is mentioned in both, but there's an ambiguity in Luke 3:23. It says Jesus began his ministry at around 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, of Joseph. But then it says, of Heli, of Mathat, and it goes on through a line all the way back to Adam. Now, it says Jesus was supposed, that is, most people assumed, that he was from Joseph. But we know that he wasn't. Both Luke and Matthew tell us that he wasn't. Matthew tells us that Mary was pregnant before she and Joseph came together in Matthew chapter 1, and she was a virgin. Luke also tells us that in Luke chapter 1, an angel came to Mary and told her she's going to have a child. She said, I've not known a man. And the angel said, well, that's okay. The Spirit of God will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore, that holy thing that will be born from you shall be called the Son of God. Now, in other words, both Matthew and Luke tell us Jesus was not the son of Joseph. But Matthew gives the royal genealogy of Joseph because this, when he adopted Jesus as his firstborn, this gives Jesus royal genealogy, but without the curse, because Jesus is not actually a son of Jeconiah. He's not the offspring of Jeconiah. So Jesus gets through that loophole. Now, on the other hand, Jesus did have to be a child of David. The Messiah definitely had to be of the seed of David. And in Luke 3:23, the genealogy that begins there, it goes through David also, but it not through Solomon, as Matthew's does, but through a different son of David named Nathan. So that means that whoever's genealogy we're reading about in Luke 23 was in fact descended from David, but not through Solomon, but through another son of David named Nathan. So that person came through a different line, but from David. So I believe that was Mary's genealogy. And therefore, we would say Jesus was literally a son of David through his mother's line, but he avoided being the son of Jeconiah because he wasn't the actual physical son of Joseph. Yet his legal standing, the legal standing of his family with Joseph as its head, would be the royal lineage. And therefore, Jesus could be the next son in line for the throne and yet have avoided that curse in Jeremiah. Now, remember when the wise men came, they were asking in Jerusalem, where is he who is born king of the Jews? And Jesus is probably the only person ever who was born king of the Jews after that, because he, you know, anyone who came from Jeconiah couldn't be. Anyone who didn't come from Jeconiah couldn't be. But Matthew came through Jeconiah and Jesus didn't. But Joseph. So we have here an interesting thing. If Mary's genealogy is given in Luke chapter 3, but Mary's name is not found there. what it says is very ambiguous. It says Jesus was 30 years old, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph. But then it says, of Heli, of Mathat. And if we would put parentheses around the entire clause, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, that's saying on the aside, people thought of him as the son of Joseph, but he was in fact of Heli. Well, who's Heli then? Well, if he's who Jesus came through, it'd be Mary's father, because Mary was his mother. It'd be his maternal grandfather. And we would then have Heli's genealogy going back through Nathan to David and so forth, so that Mary came through that line. And it'd be the actual bloodline of Jesus through his mother. And that's what I believe it is. Now, there are people who could object that say, well, that doesn't really say that it's Mary's, but it can certainly be read that way. And this is interesting. Matthew and Luke both have birth narratives of Jesus. Mark and John don't have any. The story of Jesus begins in Matthew and in Luke with the birth of Jesus and John the Baptist, where Mark and John just begin the story when Jesus is grown up. Now, Matthew's birth narratives are all told from Joseph's side. You have Joseph's genealogy. You have Joseph's visit from the angel, who tells him that Mary's, a virgin still. You have the angels coming to Joseph, telling him to flee to Egypt, and coming to Joseph, telling him to bring the family back to Israel, and then telling Joseph not to stay in Judah, but to go to Galilee. It's all about Joseph. Matthew's all about Joseph. And by the way, he has Joseph's genealogy. Luke, on the other hand, has almost nothing about Joseph. It starts with the birth of John the Baptist, who's on Mary's side of the family, the son of Mary's cousin, Elizabeth. Then the angel comes to Mary and speaks to her. And then Mary visits Elizabeth and they prophesy and so forth. And then there's a genealogy. And it would make sense, since Luke seems to be following Mary's side of the story and Matthew follows Joseph's, that Mary's genealogy is probably the one that Luke gives us. So I think there's good reason to answer that way. I don't believe they contradict each other, because they're not the genealogies of the same person. And by the way, the only way that Matthew or Luke would be able to list a genealogy of anybody going back so far would be if there were some temple records available to do so. And there probably would be, before the temple was destroyed. I think both Matthew and Luke wrote before the temple was destroyed. And they would have, it's like if I was going to write a story about somebody that I didn't know their background by heart, I'd go to the library and start looking it up. And, Matthew and Luke both would have had to go to the temple to get their records. But if they are both getting the records on the same person, the records would have the same names in them. It's clear that Matthew got the records on Joseph's genealogy. Luke didn't, or else he would have the same names in it. It seems evident that Luke gave Mary's genealogy. So that's why it appears contradictory. All right. There are those lectures about alleged discrepancies at the website, thenarrowpath.com, under topical lectures in the series called Authority of Scripture. I give lots of examples of what people think are contradictions in the Bible and explain how they're resolved.
All right, thank you.
All right, good talking to you. Let's talk to Patience next. Now, Patience, are you calling from South Africa, as I recall?
Scotland.
You're in Scotland, so you're a different person.
Yes, okay. No, I'm the same. I moved to Scotland.
You moved. Okay, you moved. Yes. I see they have rainbows there in Scotland.
Yes, there is. That was just last night. Thank you for what you do, Steve. I really appreciate. So I have two questions. And one of the first question would be, I was listening to a dispensational teacher on Daniel 7, on the 70 weeks of Daniel, and his explanation on the gap that they put in said, the reason why is because there's 69 weeks, and then there's a break, and then there's the 70th week. So okay. That's how they explain the gap that there is on the 70 weeks of Daniel. So I just wanted to get your comment on that.
Yes. Now, the prophecy is found in Daniel 9, verses 24 through 27. And it basically says there's going to be a 70-week period from a starting point to an ending point. Now, the 70 weeks, all scholars seem to agree that the weeks means not 7-day weeks, but 7-year periods. So it's like 70 seasons of 7 years each. So that's 490 years. And the starting point is a little ambiguous. It starts with the going forth of a decree to restore and build Jerusalem. But there were three decrees like that within less than a century of each other. And so different scholars begin that 490 years at different places. But all would agree that 490 years would have run out by the certainly before the first century had ended. But the ending of that period is said to be the coming of the Messiah, the Prince. Well, Jesus came well within the period of time that would indicate. Now, in talking about the 70 weeks, the angel breaks it into three portions. It says there will be 7 weeks, and then 72 weeks, and then there will be another week. So you've got 7 weeks plus 62 makes 69, and then the last one is the 70th. Now, it's not clear why it's broken up quite that way, but the truth is, nobody claims that there's any gap between the first 7 weeks and the next 62 weeks, although the prophecy itself breaks it into those pieces. No one ever suggested, well, the 70 weeks happens first, that's 49 years, and then there's a long period of time, and then you've got the 62 weeks, and then there's a long period of time, and then there's the 70th week. Nobody sees it that way. No one's even tried. Everyone agrees the first 69 weeks, although they are broken into two segments in the prophecy, they run concurrently. So, consecutively. You've got 483 years occupied at the 69 weeks. Now, naturally, you'd expect the 70th week to happen right after the end of the 69th week. This is, after all, a period of 490 years. And at the end of 69 weeks, 483 years of that period has passed. There's only 7 years more, and that's the last week. So, you know, you would think the 70th week would come immediately after the 69th week. And in fact, unless you bring in some imaginary tools of interpretation, that's exactly what did happen. The 70th week did happen right after the 69th week. Jesus did come in that period of time. It mentions that in the midst of the week, he, the Messiah, will end the sacrificial system. Well, Jesus began the 70th week with his baptism. 3.5 years later, in the midst of that week, he ended the sacrificial system by dying and bringing it to its end. And then later it says, Jerusalem will be destroyed by an army that comes in. Well, that happened in 70 AD, but that wasn't within the 70 weeks. But the point is, there's no hint in the passage that there's a gap between the 69th and 70th week. You have to invent one if you want one to be there. But that's not a very good way to do biblical studies. If you want the Bible to say something and it doesn't say it, it's not a very good idea to just invent stuff and stick it in there so that the Bible appears to say what you wish it had said. The reason that the dispensationalists do that, they want the 70th week of Daniel to be the future 7-year tribulation. And so they have to say, well, Jesus came at the end of the 69th week, but then the next week didn't begin. In fact, it was put on hold, it was postponed. And after the rapture of the church, then the 70th week will begin. So on that view, we've got like 2,000 years almost between the end of the 69th week and the beginning of the 70th week, which hasn't come yet. Now, that's absurd. If it was going to be a total of 2,500 years, why would the angel say it's going to be 490 years? It's ridiculous. The dispensationalists, it's interesting. Dispensationalism is a system where the advocates say that they are uniquely committed to literal interpretation of prophecy. they criticize amillennialists because we spiritualize some things in prophecy. Well, so do they. But they insist that they don't. They insist they take it all literally. But when you take a prophecy that speaks of 490 consecutive years between one event and another, and they say, well, it's actually 2,500 years, essentially, between those two events, because there's a 2,000-year gap in there between the 69th and 70th week. They're making that up out of thin air. There's nothing in the Bible to give a hint about that. They want it to be there, so they stick it there. And frankly, there's no good reason for it. If you want a more lengthy treatment of that subject, I have, of course, verse-by-verse lectures through Daniel at the website. And the lectures on Daniel 9, I go into this in detail.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Now, my final question is, I was speaking to a brother who is a dispensationalist, and we were talking about Israel. And he mentions that the prophecy in Psalm 83, verse 4, had not been fulfilled, that when all nations says, let's gather and destroy Israel and remove them from the face of the earth. What would be your comment on that?
Well, Psalm 83 is not a prophecy. So,
well, he takes it to be a prophecy to say the nations will gather and say, let us destroy Israel and remove the name from the face of the earth.
Well, why would they say that's a prophecy? It's a psalm. I mean, if it's a messianic psalm, it could be seen as a prophecy. Let's see here. What verses are they talking about? I guess verses 3 and 4.
Yes.
He says, behold, your enemies make a tumult. Doesn't say they will, it says they do. The writer of the psalm says that's what his enemies were doing. That's present tense. He says, those who hate you have lifted up their head. They have taken crafty counsel. That's past tense, not future tense. They have taken crafty counsel against your people and consulted together against your sheltered ones. They have said, come, let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be remembered no more. They have consulted together with one consent, blah, 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 blah. Well, there's no prophecy here. When the psalmist says, wow, this is happening. This has happened. These people are doing this. These people are consulting to destroy us. Yeah, that happened a lot in Israel's history. It obviously was happening at the time when the sons of Asaph wrote this psalm, but nothing in it looks like a prophecy to me.
Right. Okay. Thank you, Steve.
Okay. Good talking to you, Patience. Okay, Austin Bryant, welcome.
Hey, brother. So good to see you and be here with you. I just had a question. Your view on the rapture. What is your view on the rapture?
Well, the rapture is it accompanies the resurrection. That's what Paul says. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up, which is referring to the rapture. So two events happen when Jesus returns. I mean, more than two do. There's actually several things happen, but among the things that happen, two of them are the resurrection and the rapture. Now, Paul in 1 Thessalonians 4, where he's talking about that,
yes,
he identifies the timing as the coming of the Lord. He says, for those of us who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not precede those who have fallen asleep. He says, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet them in the Lord air, and thus shall we ever be with the Lord. So, so Jesus is going to come with a shout, with a trumpet. He's going to descend from heaven. He's going to catch us up to meet him in the air along with the dead. The dead will rise first. Then the living will be caught up. That's the rapture. And the word that's used there, it just says to meet the Lord in the air, the word meet, is found two other places in the New Testament. One of them is in Matthew 25, verse 1, when it says, the kingdom of God is like 10 bridesmaids that went out to meet the bridegroom. Now, what were they going to do? They're going to meet the bridegroom to accompany him the remainder of his journey to the bride's house. They are from the bride's house. They're going out to intercept the arriving bridegroom so that they can, like a welcoming committee, light the way for him with their lamps to find his way back to the house to take the bride. So, the bride's maids go out to meet the groom. That means they go out to meet him so that they can accompany him on the remainder of his trip. He's not going to change direction. They are. Now, the other time that's found in the New Testament is in Acts chapter 28, where it says that when Paul was coming on foot to Rome, that the brethren or the Christians in Rome heard he was coming and they went out to meet him. What for? Well, apparently to accompany him into Rome. They were in Rome already. He was coming to Rome. They went out to meet him so they could welcome him into Rome, bring him in. The word refers to a welcoming committee going to accompany the arriving dignitary, to so that he doesn't have to arrive at his destination alone. They come up to greet him and travel with him there. So when Paul says that we're going to meet the Lord in the air, the suggestion is we're going to go up there and meet him, and he's going to keep coming down. We're going to come down with him. So that's what I believe about the rapture. And there's nothing in the Bible that places it in any other time frame. It's he's always said to take place at the second coming of Christ.
All right.
Jesus himself said he was going to raise his people up on the last day. So, so obviously no time prior to the last day will be the rapture. He's going to raise us up on the last day.
Let me see where I want to go with this one. Zechariah. I was finishing that the other day, and the end of it, does that speak of judgment or fulfillment that has already happened of them coming out of Babylon?
I believe that the return of the exiles from Babylon is not predicted in Zechariah because Zechariah lived after they returned. He's a post-exilic prophet. There is one reference in Zechariah to additional, people coming back from Babylon, but most of them who were coming back had already come back in his time. So it's not a main theme of Zechariah's prophecy to predict this will happen. But he does.
It was Zephaniah.
Another destruction of Jerusalem, though, in Zechariah 14, 1 and 2, and following, he describes the city being destroyed again, which it was in 70 AD.
I mixed my book up there. I meant Zephaniah. So Zephaniah chapter 3. Is that talking about the judgment on Jerusalem and then them coming out of Babylon? So this is an spot speaking of end time fulfillment.
Zephaniah was probably prophesying around the same time as Jeremiah, which was when the Babylonian exile was happening. It had not happened yet, but it was coming. And then they do. All the prophets, pretty much, who speak of the Babylonian exile, they also predict the return of the exiles.
And then my last one, I kind of get some words mixed up of what I start off here. It's in Romans 5:12, talking about death in Adam and life in Christ. Mm-hmm. I know that Christ was talking about the greater Moses. I may have mixed it up with the greater Adam, but it talks about that one man had brought sin into the world, so death reigned through all everybody. And then it says in verse 18, therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. And so now this being a gift, do we have this is must be received, because this is where I get caught up with
you're talking about 18.
Limited, verse 18, verse 17 and 18, but yeah, so speak a little bit on this and limited atonement, because I would think that Christ's death atoned for everyone, but if you don't accept that, then it's you're not accepting that gift, so therefore, his atonement's not going to,
Right. Well, Paul never taught, the Bible never teaches limited atonement, but the Calvinists believe in that.
Right.
A verse like this makes it very clear that Jesus died so that all may be justified. So that wouldn't happen if he only died for a few or for the elect only or whatever. Yeah, that Jesus died for more people than are saved is generally accepted to be based on the assumption that Jesus died for all, but not all people will benefit because they won't receive it. Not all will be reconciled with him. Now, there is a view called universal reconciliation that thinks all people eventually will be reconciled to God. If that view is correct, then it's correct. But if it's not correct, then we'd have to assume that God has paid the penalty through Christ for all people to be saved. But being saved requires them being reunited with God. See, it's like if I was alienated from a man because he did some great thing against me. Let's say he was driving drunk and he killed my kid or something like that, you know. Well, he knows he did. He's afraid to see me. He doesn't ever want to see me again because he feels so guilty. And frankly, I'm not too happy with him either. But I could forgive him, but we still wouldn't have a relationship unless something went beyond that, beyond me forgiving him for doing it. He'd have to want to be reconciled. He'd have to want to come and, you know, be a friend again. And so Jesus can have done all that for us, and people could still not want to be his friend, not want to be reconciled to him. So that would be the conditionalness of it. You know, many of these questions, I mean, you're certainly welcome to ask them there, but if you don't get your question asked, you can almost always go to my lectures. I mean, on any passage, we've got verse by verse lectures of mine on the website you can go to, or on any subject, or to Matthew7:13.com, where it's got 20,000 of my answers to questions that have been asked. Let's talk to Junior Leo next. Good to talk to you, brother.
Yeah. So I'm in a book club and we're having a debate on the Trinity. And one of the questions that was asked was, where in the Bible does it says to worship the Holy Spirit as opposed to evidence of people worshiping Jesus? And my response was that, this is the same question, you know, Jehovah Witness will ask the same question where it says to worship Jesus. But I wanted to know, how would you respond to that? I gave my response, but I want to know, how would you respond to that where nowhere blatantly says, you know, worship the Holy Spirit?
Yeah, I would agree. I don't know of any place in the Bible that says blatantly to worship the Holy Spirit. I don't see any reason for that to affect the Trinity doctrine, though. We are told to worship the Father, and the Father commands us to worship the Son. Jesus never taught us to worship the Holy Spirit, but that doesn't mean that there aren't three in the Godhead. When we worship God, I assume we're worshiping all three. But the Bible does say the Holy Spirit is God. I mean, it says in 2 Corinthians 3:17, the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. Jesus said, he that loves me keeps my commandments, my Father will love him, and we will come and make our home with him. Who's we? The Father and he. Well, who's he talking about coming? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit coming to be in us is the Father and the Son coming into us. The Holy Spirit is referred to as God when Peter is rebuking Ananias and Sapphira. He says, you've lied to the Holy Spirit. You've lied to God. So, I mean, the fact that there are things in the Bible that refer to the Holy Spirit as God is enough. I mean, okay, so we're not told to worship the Holy Spirit specifically. Okay, fine. But that doesn't prove or disprove the Trinity. It's kind of a peripheral point, it seems to me. The real question is, does the Bible teach that the Holy Spirit is God? Now, if somebody says, I'm not convinced that the Holy Spirit is God. I just think the Father and the Son are God. Well, okay, they can hold that view if they want to. I don't think they'll be correct. The Bible doesn't say that you have to believe any particular thing about the Holy Spirit being God to be saved. We have to differentiate between what someone has to believe to be saved on the one hand, and what they have to believe to be right on the other. Because many people are saved who aren't right about lots of things. You can be wrong about many things and still be saved if you're a follower of Christ. And so You know, sometimes people really say, well, I know the Trinity is true, so if people don't believe in the Trinity, they can't be saved. Well, I don't know if the Bible ever says that. The Bible says we have to believe in God, we have to believe in Christ, we have to receive the Holy Spirit. But how we interpret the relationship of those three is never really made it. The Bible doesn't make an issue of all that in a Trinitarian sense. But theologians are people who try to put together all the data of Scripture into a harmonious whole that doesn't, so that nothing contradicts anything else. And that's how the Trinity is arrived at, you know. So, yeah, I honestly don't debate the Trinity much anymore. I used to love to debate the Trinity against Jehovah's Witnesses and anyone else who wanted to argue about it. And then I realized that Jesus never debated the Trinity, and Paul never debated the Trinity, and they never even defined the Trinity. So I feel like, okay, maybe that's not a front burner debate issue. The real issue is, the Bible says if you believe that Jesus is Lord, you believe he's the Messiah, you believe he's the Son of God, and that he died and rose for your sins, died for your sins and rose again, well, then you'll be saved. And so from that point on, the rest is just getting to know God. When the apostles first left their nets to follow Jesus, they didn't know he was God. They didn't even know who he was for sure. They knew he was God's man. They knew he was someone that was going to teach them about the kingdom of God. And it only dawned on them gradually, who he was. They didn't know right away. But they were still his followers even before they understood it. So that's how I would see it. I wouldn't debate the matter. And certainly that particular point is not a compelling one, it seems to me.
Thank you, and hope to see you soon in the region. I moved to Maryland, by the way.
Oh, you did? Okay, great. Well, I may come out that way again. I was in Nashville a while ago and in Knoxville, Tennessee. So I was kind of close to the eastern seaboard, but didn't quite go over to the coastal states. Anyway, yeah, I'll hope to see you again when I come over there.
Very well, and I'll present you my son.
I'd love to meet him, love to see him, because you weren't even married when I saw you last. Or you had,
yeah.
You just got married when I met. Sorry, yes, yeah.
Yep.
All right.
Very well. God bless.
Okay.
Have a good night.
You too. Kevin.
Brother Steve, how are you? I'll try to be quick to the point here. Help me understand. It appears to me that God has placed a greater measure of the law of good in some men as opposed to others, right? Just like some men
naturally, you mean naturally, or you mean
yes. Yeah. I mean, in other words, God gives some people that law of good more so than others. And I'll give you an example. Some men have a little bit more estrogen than other men, have more testosterone, so they function differently. And I'm looking at Job and Enoch in the Old Testament without the Holy Spirit. And here Job says, I make a covenant with my eyes. Here's a man making a covenant with his eyes. He doesn't have the Holy Spirit. And we've got brothers in the church that have no desire to make a covenant with their eyes. You understand what I'm saying? But he's doing it without the Spirit. And then Enoch walks with God for 300 years and then is no more. And then Paul says that he desires to do the good, right? In 22, it says, for I delight in the law of God according to the inward man, right? But even Paul indicates, but I see another law in my members. How would you explain that other law in Paul's members was not impacting Job and Enoch to the same degree?
Well, it may have been. It may have been. To say that Job and Enoch never sinned ever at all would be to contradict Scripture in general. You know, all have sinned. But Job and Enoch, they were blameless. But then so am I, even though I have sinned. I'm blameless because God has removed the blame. He's placed the blame on Christ. Because when people repent and come clean with God, and they offer, in the Old Testament, they offered these sacrifices and so forth out of obedience to God, I believe that they were forgiven and they could be blameless. So I think that a person who lived in sin was a very different situation. I believe lots of men lived fairly blameless lives. And it may be that they had a temperamental inclination toward it, or maybe they just had better upbringing, or maybe they lived in situations with less temptation. I mean, there's all kinds of factors that would explain why some men struggle with stuff that other men don't seem to struggle as much with. Now, Paul, when he said that in his mind, he approved of the law of God, but he found in his members a law that brought him into bondage, so he did what he hated. I think people overread that and make it sound, in their mind, they think Paul's just saying, boy, I'm just sinning every time I turn around, you know? I don't think that's true. I think that when Paul is saying, I want to be perfect, but there's something in me that keeps me from being perfect. I sin. I don't want to sin. I don't want to sin, but sometimes I do. Well, I think every spiritual man would say that. I mean, you read about famous monks and so forth in the Eastern Church or in the Western Church. They're godly men. They're always afflicted by their conscience over their sins. But that's because they're so holy that their sins really bug them. I think when a person is more compromised, they're less bugged by their sin. I think it's just more natural to them to make excuses for it and so forth. But the more a man tries to be holy and perfect, the more intolerant he becomes of whatever sins he ever does commit. And everyone commits some. I think Job no doubt committed some. Enoch no doubt committed some, but they repented. And I believe they lived lives that were on good terms with God, just like we can. Now, they don't have the Holy Spirit, we say, but maybe they did. Not everyone did. God did put his Holy Spirit on some men in the Old Testament, the prophets, for example, and David and so forth. And we don't know for sure if God put his Spirit on Job or Enoch. But even with the Holy Spirit, obviously, like you said, men still sometimes struggle with stuff. And of course, I will say this, with Job making a covenant with his eyes, it probably wasn't too hard for Job to avoid looking at women if he's out with his sheep and with his wife almost, you know, 24/7. You know, I mean, there's not many women to look at. Most of the men you know who struggle with their eyes probably are surrounded by billboards and advertisements and tabloid covers at the checkout stands and women dressed scantily everywhere they look. I mean, let's face it, in ancient times, that stuff wouldn't have been permitted in a godly man's home or society. And so, I mean, I find it's a lot easier for me not to sin with my eyes or my mind when I'm kind of alone most of the time, or when I'm with the brothers, or when, you know, things like that. It's when you're immersed in imagery that's calculated to stir up your lust that's when you struggle with it. And I think, you know, Paul was a metropolitan man. He lived in cities, and you know, he may have had struggles with his eyes that we don't know about. He didn't mention it specifically, but could have. But Job lived out in the, you know, pastures with, he was a farmer, you know, I mean, and to say he made a covenant with his eyes that he wouldn't look at a maid doesn't mean he never broke that covenant. It means he had that commitment. And so do I, and so do you. We have the commitment also that we won't look at a woman inappropriately. And Job did too. He probably had fewer temptations along those lines because of his lifestyle and his location, but every man has got the same battles, and some manage it a little better than others.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate it. Appreciate your time.
Have a good talk to you. All right, let's talk to Chris, and it looks like Chris is going to be our last one today. Hi, Chris.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you now. Yes, I can't see you though.
Okay, that's fine. My question is about the relationship with God. And I'm a long-time listener, first-time Zoomer. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, it talks about the fragrance of the knowledge of God for the believer, and that it is a sweet fragrance, but for the unbeliever, it is...
fragrance of death.
That's right. And I recently had face-to-face contact with family who are unbelievers, and I was just wanting to get some interface with you about that. And firstly, and secondly, does that scent of death come from just the unbelievers, or is it from all of us?
No, the scent of death, he's not saying that the scent of death comes from the unbelievers. He's alluding to a well-known custom of the time. The language he uses in that passage in 2 Corinthians 2 is taken from the Roman ceremony of celebrating a conquering general. When he comes back from the battlefield, he usually would bring back in chains the kings or the rulers or the generals that he had conquered and bring them back to Rome. And as he was coming, those in Rome would set up an arch of triumph. And you can still go to Rome and see Titus's Arch of Triumph, for example, when he conquered Jerusalem. But the Arch of Triumph was set up for a parade, and the conquering Roman general would bring his captives in chains and parade them through the Arch of Triumph and through the streets of Rome. In front of him, there'd be incense carriers, swinging incense censers back and forth and filling the space with the aroma of incense. And they'd be going through the city to the place where they're going to execute the prisoners.
Yes.
So, and Paul says in that passage, he says, God causes us to triumph. Actually, in the Greek, it says, he leads us forth in triumph. The imagery is that Jesus is the conquering general of heaven. He has conquered us. We have those who have surrendered to him. We're on his side now. But we parade with him, as it were. We're on display to the angels and to the world, I suppose, as those that he has conquered. And the smell of the incense that was so common with those who were watching a Roman triumphal entry. He's saying that the knowledge of God is diffused from us like this aroma. And to those who are being saved, it's a celebration. It's a happy aroma. It's an aroma of life. It's a positive experience to smell that incense. But those who are condemned, those who are going to die, who are going to be executed, like the prisoners in the imagery, that aroma is just the aroma of their impending doom. Now, what I think he's saying is that the knowledge of God, which is made known through us in the world, the knowledge of God is diffused throughout the world through us as we follow Christ. Yes. The knowledge of God is a welcome thing to those who want to know God, those who want to believe and follow him. But to those who don't want to, it's a stink. It speaks of their impending doom. I mean, I don't know if you've ever seen atheists like Richard Dawkins or Christopher Hitchens or Sam Harris or some of these atheists who really pretty much hate God, and they hate hearing about God. I mean, nothing annoys them more than that there are people who love God.
Yes.
And that keep alive in our society the knowledge that there is a God. Yes. The knowledge of God is a stink to them. Why? They're not on good terms with him. That's why. Yes. And he's going to judge them. So I think that's what Paul's referring to in that passage.
Yes. Thank you so much. That's exactly what I was, my experience was with my unbelieving family.
Yeah, they don't like it. Unless they do. If they do like it, they're probably about to become Christians. When people are drawn to Christ, they love to hear the knowledge of God. But when they...
Thank you so much, Steve.
God bless you, Chris. Thanks for your call.
God bless.
You too.
Okay. Well, everybody, thank you. Steve, thank you very much for this. Want to let you guys all know we'll be back August 7th. So if you can tune in, that's the first Wednesday next month. So hopefully you can be there. Also, Boyd, I see you're still on. I'm going to say something. Steve may not like it that much, but I'll tell you, I have the same problem sleeping. I listen to The Narrow Path. Right now I'm listening to 2016 July and just listening to every show. So the whistling at the beginning kind of lets my mind know it's time for bed. It's on the app. I just put it on there. And then the questions, mm-hmm. what's nice about it is you can say, well, you get too interested in it. Actually, what it does is it takes my mind off what's going on that day. If I'm worried about something or this, I just listen to that. And the questions and answers just kind of knocks me out. It's not that Steve's boring to listen to. I don't want to put
You don't have to listen too long before a boring question comes.
But it does take your mind off the day. And that whistling, every time I hear that, and sometimes I wake up in the middle of the night and it's like, I'll put on the next episode and listen to it. And it works good, boys. So try that. I've tried Calm. I've tried other apps for sleep. I have same issues with sleep, but believe me, the Narrow Path worked even better than J. Vernon McGee. Used to do that even before Steve Gregg.
If you go into the series of John, it doesn't have the whistling in the beginning and the end of those.
Yeah, and I do the question answer. I tried the topical lectures, but actually I kind of like to listen to those so that my mind gets a little more engaged in those. But the questions and answers, I think it's because it's so random. Try that. Just go back to like 2016, 2014, start 1 month and just start going through I just do it on my phone and just either the app or the website. Works great for me. But anyway, that give it a shot, boy. Let me know next month if it works. We did have a few other questions for those of you that wanted to ask. Sorry about that. Please check in August 7th. We'll get back to those and get you on there. Steve, do you want to close us in prayer?
Sure. Father, I pray for those who have struggles, like Boyd with his sleep problems and Michael too, and others that maybe didn't share their problems, but we are a family of concern. I pray that we can bear one another's burdens, if only in praying for each other. Lord, we're living in troubled times and troubling times, and I pray that you give us peace and give your beloved sleep, as you said you would. Even if they have to listen to the Narrow Path to fall asleep, I pray that you'll bless each one as they go to bed now. I hope they are going to bed now, and guide us every day, tomorrow and every day thereafter, to follow you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Steve. Amen.
All right, it's great seeing all you guys.
Good seeing you.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye now.
God bless.